Now, when I talk about serve, let me just say this. I'm not going to talk about how to serve one another better, all right? That's not what this is about. The whole series is called Bless, and it's about relational evangelism. Two big words, relational evangelism. What does that mean? It means this: we're building a relational bridge strong enough to hold the weight of truth. That's a powerful statement. We are building a relational bridge with those around us strong enough to support the weight of truth. Eons ago, back when I was in Bible college, we had to do this thing called Christian service. Brilliant name. But one of the things that we had to do was what was known as open-air evangelism. I don't know if you've ever even heard of the concept, but it's basically exactly what you think. That you get down into a city street corner and just preach, I guess, all right, to anybody passing by. It was one of the most frustrating things I've ever experienced, because you don't have to be there long to know how irrelevant this is, how hardly anybody's even caring about what is being said. There was a lot of truth being presented, but there wasn't a relational bridge strong enough to hold that truth. So we're about doing that. See, Jesus doesn't want to just have us be people that excel in acts of kindness. We've all heard that concept. Or just, you know, maybe even reaching out and doing outreaches into our community. That Heritage Church does very well. And that, those things aren't bad, okay? They're biblical. They're really good. But Jesus is calling us to be legendary servers. That's just the baseline of how we're meant to live in general. So serving in light of relational evangelism is calling us to step up our intentionality to go to the next level, to live in radical love. So what does that look like? This is what we're going to be talking about today. We're going to be in Luke chapter 5. This is an amazing story, okay? Let me give you a little bit of background to this before we dive in. Luke is the author, okay? He is a doctor. Now, all I say that because what that means to me is that he's very detail-oriented. He believes details matter. Some of the details he writes, the other gospel writers, even though they talk about the same stories, the same events, they will leave out details that Luke puts in because details matter to Luke. And so some of the background here is that this is about a year into Jesus' ministry, which lasted about 3 years. And so there was tremendous momentum in Jesus' ministry at this point. Everybody had heard of Jesus. Man, people would travel days just to get close to this man. He taught like nobody else taught. He taught with wisdom and authority. And he was performing miracles. He had already done his first sermon at this point, the famous sermon called the Sermon on the Mount. Almost got him killed, by the way. That's a good sermon. He had already performed miracles, turned the water into wine at a wedding party. He cast out demons, healed lots of people with leprosy, filled fishing boats overflowing with fish more than the fishermen could handle. All sorts of things. He had called his first disciples at this point. And so there was lots of things going, lots of momentum going in the life of Jesus. Everywhere he went, mobs of people. In fact, another gospel writer, Mark, says about this time in Mark chapter 1, Jesus could no longer enter a town openly, but stayed outside in lonely places, yet the people still came to see him from where? Everywhere. Everywhere. This is the difference, again, between Luke and the other gospel writers. Luke says, man, they came from everywhere, man. Everywhere. Luke will actually define it when we get there, okay? Where is everywhere? So this is where we find Jesus in Luke chapter 5, starting in verse 17. We're actually going to start in verse 15. It says, yet the news about him spread all the more. so that crowds of people came to hear him and to be healed of their sickness. But Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. One day, Jesus was teaching. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law were sitting there. They had come from every village of, and again, Luke is more precise, Galilee and from Judea and Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was with Jesus to heal the sick. Now, let me just pause there for a second because there's a lot going on here. First off, I just want to draw your attention to this phrase, but Jesus often withdrew to lonely places to pray. In the heights of his momentum and movement, Jesus had intentional moments of prayer and preparation. Remember how this series started? Begin with prayer. Begin with prayer. That actually matters. And it's not just a one-and-done deal. Jesus' habit, his rhythm, his intentional rhythm, was building this life of prayer, getting by himself and praying. You don't have to take my word for it. Just Jesus did it. Second thing I just want you to understand is that this story happens in the town of Capernaum. Now, Capernaum's on the northwest side of the Sea of Galilee. A lot happens in Capernaum. That's where he called his first disciples. That's where Simon Peter's hometown was. It's right there on the Sea of Galilee. Is that he started walking on the water, if you remember that story. This was kind of the home base for Jesus. So, you know, where it says wherever Jesus went, there was throngs of people. When he went to his hometown of Capernaum, you could just up that ante. Okay, and so he was in this house of Capernaum, and it was wall-to-wall people. There was standing room only. There's people crowding in on the outside, just trying to get close to hear. Maybe they needed a touch from Jesus. They wanted to hear this Jesus who they've heard about. Maybe they were sick and they needed to get healed. You know, there was no scalpers back then. You know, front row tickets, got front row tickets, nothing like that. And so they were in this house. There's a very interesting detail, again, that Luke puts in. One day Jesus was teaching. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law were sitting there. That's easy just to kind of skip over. But there is something really powerful going on here. You talk about tension. Whew. Back in that culture, it was very traditional for the teacher, the, you know, priest or Pharisee, would be sitting. That was a place of honor, to be sitting. Everybody else would be standing. It'd be exactly opposite of what we're doing here, okay? We would all be sitting, and then the teacher would be standing. And so when they came in this very crowded room and demanded to sit, that was a statement. It would almost be like if you've ever, I think all of us have experienced going into a very crowded elevator, you know, where you're just kind of wall to wall. If you were to go into that crowded elevator and then sat and crossed your feet and just sat there, would you take more room or less room than if you stood? More, right? You would look at this and say, man, that's kind of rude. But in reality, what was happening is that these Pharisees and religious leaders and these teachers of the law, they were sitting down because they were publicly making a statement that they don't recognize Jesus' teaching authority. They wouldn't join in. They wouldn't be like those misguided crowds of people acknowledging him as a rabbi or a teacher. And just by the fact that they sat down, they demanded in this crowded environment that they sat down, they did not recognize him for who he says he is. They did not give him 1 ounce of respect or authority. And so you just got to see the tension in the room, the power play going out on without a word being spoken. Then we go on to verse 18. And it says, some men came carrying a paralyzed man on a sleeping mat. From other gospel accounts of this, there were 4 men, 4 friends of this paralyzed person. Now, Let me just speak to that for a moment because there's another powerful cultural thing going on here. There are people in here that have a physical disability. And man, I see how you handle that with grace and dignity and honor. And we are so privileged that you are part of our family here in Heritage Barrington. But as much of an issue that is today, it was 100 times worse back in Jesus' day. Because any physical disability that you had was associated with either a spiritual sin, a huge sin, that you are being punished for, or something that your parents did that you would be punished for. And so this man lived with this stigma his whole life. He was a horrible sinner who was being punished. Everybody looked at him like this. So this paralytic guy lives his whole life with that stigma. He lives his whole life on a mat, just lying there. That was his only real estate he'd owned. Somebody had to feed him. Somebody had to carry him. Somebody had to clean him. He was dependent upon somebody else for everything in his life. There was no medical treatment, no physical therapy, no hope of ever doing anything but lying on the side of the road begging for coins as people passed by. He had no job, no cash, no influence, probably no family. Pretty bleak for future. Well, so what now? In verse 19, these four friends, they tried to take him inside the house to see Jesus. But they couldn't reach him because of the crowd. Overwhelmingly huge numbers of people. So they went up to the roof and took off some tiles. Then they lowered the sick man on his mat down into the crowd right in front of Jesus. Whoa. Okay? This is amazing. This is where when I was evaluating how I would respond in this situation, I had to conclude I wouldn't be a very good friend to this paralyzed guy. I don't have the creativity, and I don't have the wherewithal to keep going past, you know, a block like this. I would have probably got him there, you know, carried him there, and then saw the incredible amount of people and would have said, well, you know, we tried. So sorry. But evidently Jesus is pretty busy now, and maybe we'll run into him another time. Not these four guys. No. They saw this as an opportunity to excel beyond the issue that they were facing. The kind of the architecture of the day where these houses, they had staircases that went up to the roof in the back of the house. And so they said, well, let's try this. So they went up to the staircase to the roof, not just to get a better view of Jesus, but to actually think outside the box to get their friend in front of Jesus. So you can imagine the tension in the room. Just imagine, if you would, right now, if somebody were up there kind of hitting away and starting to, you know, break open the roof, and sunlight would start shining through and dust would start coming down, would you be as distracted at all? Every one of us would. You know, and so this happened, and this paralytic man gets lowered down, and everybody, you thought the tension was high before, but now people were looking at Jesus going, oh man, what's he going to say? Ooh, is he going to be ticked? Is he going to demand that damages be paid for this house? Man, no one expected to hear what he says next. No one. But we'll come back to that. Hang on to that. I want to talk a little bit about the backstory of the four friends. We don't know much about them. We don't know how they knew each other. All we knew is that they brought him. He had a group of friends, the paralytic guy, an incredible group of guys that chose to include him. They chose to love him, do life with him, in spite of the social and spiritual stigma, in spite of what it cost. And here they heard that this famous rabbi, Jesus, is coming to town. Oh, man, they've heard about this guy. They want to, you know, make sure that, I don't know if they lived in Capernaum, but maybe they live close. So like everybody else around, they dropped everything they were doing to go hear this man Jesus. On the way, maybe they thought, well, maybe, wait a minute, we've heard that he heals people too. So what happens if we run by and pick up our friend? They got there, and do something totally that no one's expecting in order to get their friend to Jesus. We've heard of party crashers. Maybe you've seen the movie Wedding Crashers. These guys were roof crashers. You know, got to get our friend to Jesus. This might be his only shot. They chose the relationship coming to Jesus above that which was convenient and conventional and culturally acceptable. And Jesus, I'm sure, had to stop whatever he was teaching on, looking up and seeing this man getting lowered, and looking up past this man to see four very hopeful, maybe sweaty and dirty, faces of friends peering in, saying, could you just heal my buddy? Can you just heal him? You're not ready for what's coming next. You think you are, but you're not. Let's see what happens in verse 20. When Jesus saw their faith, their bold belief, he said, friend, your sins are forgiven. Two huge things there. Again, Luke is very precise in his writing. He says their faith, their bold belief. Whose faith did Jesus see? The paralyzed man? No. He would have probably said his faith, right? Was it the religious teachers and leaders present, the pastors in the room that were sitting there? No. Was it his disciples? No. It was the friend of the one who was hurting, that was helpless, that was paralyzed. Man, don't tell me our friendships with people around us don't matter. When even they don't even know they need a relationship to Jesus. Our faith in what Jesus can do for that person, if we're successful in getting him to the feet of Jesus, oh, so powerful. And Jesus said something here that nobody, again, was expecting. He said he saw their bold belief. And because of that, he said, friend, your sins are forgiven. Why did the four friends bring their paralytic friend to Jesus? To have the sins forgiven? No. To get them healed. But this is what Jesus does so well. He looks past the surface need and goes to the root, the heart of the need. And said, I'm going to do something for you that you have a bigger need in your life. You have grown up every day with people all around you, these religious leaders who are sitting here, thinking that you are a moral and spiritual failure, that you have done some incredible sin. Imagine letting that weigh on you day after day through your whole life. And Jesus says, friend, your sins are forgiven. You're totally free, clean. And this is really what turned out to tick off the religious leaders sitting in that room. They couldn't believe that what Jesus had done. Your sins are forgiven? You see, in Jewish faith, to say you could forgive someone's sins is one of the highest levels of blasphemy. And so these religious leaders start grumbling. And said, man, this is our shot to shut Jesus up. And Jesus, because they were saying only God can forgive sins. So Jesus said, I love Jesus' response, but basically we'll do the math. You know, because I am fully God and fully man, because I am the Son of God, I can forgive sins. Verse 23, which is easier, Jesus says, to say, your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up and walk? Boy, it would seem on the surface that it's easier to say your sins are forgiven, because who's to know, right? Who's to know? It's a lot harder to say get up and walk, because either the guy does or doesn't. But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralyzed man, I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home. Immediately he stood up in front of them, took what he had been lying on all of his life, and went home praising God. Everyone was amazed and gave praise to God. They were filled with awe and said, we have seen remarkable things today. I mean, this guy had been paralyzed his whole life, gets up with a brand new start in life, totally forgiven of all his sins, that moral stigma gone, and he's also healed. I'm sure he's going, is this for real? Getting up kind of tentatively, taking those first steps, going, whoa. I can imagine he was making his way through the crowd of people with his mat, and by the time he made it outside, you know, his four friends had made it off the roof, and they were high-fiving, you know, hugging each other. Every moment of that guy's life, every moment was leading up to this one. All he knew was pain, defeat, rejection, and isolation. And now he was standing eye to eye with Jesus. He knew the power of forgiveness and freedom and the faith of his friends. In that extraordinary moment, his life was changed forever. He could walk, his sins were forgiven, his soul was free. Amazing story. Listen, I as we wrap up here, a couple of thoughts that I just had in my heart. I know when you hear a story like this, and everybody left amazed that we've seen remarkable things today, that becomes almost an expectation. And so going back to this whole thing of serve in our Bless series, we think, man, if we serve, man, we're going to see remarkable things. And this is what happens. And I'm going to be real honest with you. You know, sometimes, a lot of times, we start serving people who might be our one in our life that don't know Jesus yet. And it doesn't go like this. And slowly, we get more and more discouraged. Why? And please tune in here. Because I think we miss all that led up to that moment in Luke chapter 5. We miss the miraculous of the mundane. These four friends of this paralytic man probably served him for years before that event. Okay? Nothing really miraculous happened. Okay? But it was all in preparation for what Jesus was going to do in that house. Remember, we're building a relational bridge strong enough to hold the weight of truth. Man, if you're anything like me, when there's something absolutely paralyzing in my life that's holding me back and causing me pain, 9 times out of 10, I'm not going to trust a stranger talking to me about this mystical deity that can help in my life to fix my biggest hurt. I'm going to trust a friend who does real life with me daily and invests in the small moments. The one that you wrote on the card on the first week, the only way to bear the burden of their heart tomorrow is to take time today and invest in the ordinary. How do you do that? What difference does some small things make in the light of eternity? You know, maybe if it's your neighbor who's on your one list. Maybe it's just something simple like pulling in the trash can from the curb back to their house. Maybe if you live with your one, it's just those daily acts of service. You know, of just saying, I care. I'm thinking about you. Boy, I have to share just another thought that really hit me this week. I was reading in the book of John in chapter 15, and this is near the end of Jesus' life, where he talks about this concept, this verse, and it's a powerful verse. It says, my command is to love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no man than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. And I got to thinking, and I don't know where I'm landing on this yet, so just kind of go on the journey with me. When he said that, it's very different than when we read it. We know what happened soon after he said this. We're going to celebrate it in just a couple of weeks in Easter, right? He actually laid down his life. He died on behalf of all of us so that we could be free, so that we could have a relationship with God for eternity. When he said this to his disciples, they had no clue that was going to be happening, right? Are you with me? All they knew is what they had seen for the last 3 years of traveling and being with Jesus. How Jesus just consistently laid down his life for people. Just serving them. Just loving them. That convicted me. I think, in a way, laying down our lives and serving is really, really hard because we're selfish in nature. It's a daily, sacrificial, inconvenient, intentional practice and rhythm. When you look at your one, will you lay down your life for them so they can find theirs? Serving your one, I don't know what that looks like. I know it begins with prayer. Ask God for discernment. It involves listening. What are they going through? What are their hopes, their dreams, their passions? What are they feeling? Listen. Eating, spending intentional time with them, building relationships through quality engagement. But you better believe, as you do those three things, you're going to find out about how you can serve them. You know, you start to see the cracks, the wounds, the hurts, the obstacles, and more. And when you build a relationship and develop intentional rhythms of serving small, you start to see those things, which leads to doing unreasonable, inconvenient, roof-ripping off things in their life because you love them and because you know God loves them. And you'll do whatever it takes to get them face-to-face with Jesus. Boy, start serving with relational evangelism means starting small, leveraging everyday moments to love unconditionally. And when we do that, we start to get into the habit of carrying the burdens of the brokenness of them, and they understand they're not alone. Start small, but don't be afraid to go unreasonable. Start small, but go to the interruptible by doing the inconvenient. Start small, but go be faithful to relationships that God has put in your life.